Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to Russ and Kitty Walden's Morning Light, where you get your whole Bible back.
Welcome to Russ and Kitty Walden, and we are Morning Light. I mean, the other way around.
We really are awake.
It's a beautiful day. Hello. Looking out these windows today.
Mm-hmm. Hello, friends.
The most lovely sight outside our window is a dual-purpose grill with LP on one side and charcoal on the other, and we took a whole day to put that thing together, and then we finally grilled chicken on it yesterday.
He did a great job, guys. Mm-hmm. But beyond that is the lake view, and it's lovely. Hope you're having a beautiful spring day.
We have a weekly prayer time with some key leaders here in the local area. And I'm looking forward to having them over to come to pray. And we always have some refreshments or something, and occasionally a meal at least once a month. And so I'm looking forward to grilling for them. And I'm not a great griller. I'm not one of those aficionados, but it is something I enjoy. I'm like your grandmother. When she loves you, she cooks for you. And if you don't eat it all, she gets her feelings hurt.
No offense.
So today, Ruth chapter 3, the balm of the book of Ruth is still being poured into the wounds inflicted upon us in the book of Judges.
It's a healing chapter, isn't it? Even though it's not very long, it's got some really strong points to it. I appreciate what we're learning from the book of Ruth.
Ruth chapter 3 today. The theme that I see in this chapter is that Jesus is your Boaz. And I really appreciate the book of Ruth because I've seen some things, and as you do with expository study, when you go through it chapter by chapter, verse by verse, and not cherry-picking your subject matter, I've seen some things that hadn't occurred to me that way. Some that were new thoughts and others that have confirmed and reaffirmed some things that I've known from times past. In this chapter, Naomi instructs Ruth on how to approach Boaz in the hopes that Boaz will accept responsibility for her as a near kinsman. Ruth finds him at the threshing floor and lies down next to him as a symbolic act of inviting him to exercise the right of kinsman redeemer. And this all takes place at the threshing floor, which is so interesting. Because when we started the Jericho Drive, when we went across the country four times and ministered in 66 cities, the theme that we started out with is we are entering into the bridal season. And there is that place where we go from being the army of God, the body of Christ, to being the bride of Christ at the end of the church dispensation, if you don't mind me using that word, that he's going to reconfigure. Jesus, when he came, he reconfigured the economy of God when he made statements like, "You have heard it said in old time, but I say unto you." Mm-hmm. And there are many places where he reconfigured the economy of God from old covenant Judaism to new covenant, what became Christianity. Well, we're going to go through a time now. You need to really hear what I'm saying. We're going to see that happen before Jesus comes, because he said in Ephesians 5, he's coming back for a people that identify themselves more than a body and an army. They identify themselves as a bride. And Ruth is a type of the bride of Christ, and her interactions, her meaningful interactions with Boaz took place on the threshing floor. And the defining act was when she snuggled up to a sleeping Boaz at the threshing floor. And I heard the Lord say, some months ago, he said, "I'm bringing you." I woke up in the night. It's one of those things where the voice of God is just like booming in my spirit in the night seasons. And I woke up and it was just reverberating in my mind. "I am bringing you to rest at the threshing floor." That is a bridal season statement. And then it was just some time later that I just stumbled over, I think it was Bobby Connor, had a word almost to that exact same thing. "I'm bringing you to rest in the threshing floor." What is that about? It's about becoming the bride of Christ. It's about, and that is an individual reality because our soul is married to Christ, and it is a corporate reality as we as the church become that, where we relate to him more as bridegroom than we do as father. That there's a transitioning that takes place. That doesn't mean to say God isn't our father, and we get into these nuances of discussion about the Trinity. And we don't want to spend time doing that today. But it was a very bold thing for Ruth to go to Boaz in a public place where he was sleeping at the threshing floor. Boaz could have rejected her. He could have even had her punished for being so brazen because she was a Moabite. And he wasn't actually in technical from a technical standpoint, he actually wasn't her kinsman redeemer. He was not her next of kin. We're going to get into that. But she was an enemy of God's people. And so this interaction, now listen to me, and this is what I want you to see as we study this chapter. This interaction between Ruth and Boaz is a type of the presumptive intimacy that God wants us to initiate with him. It took boldness for Ruth to do what she did. She took her life in her hands. If others had known what she was doing, she would have been roundly criticized. Other people would not have got. That's why we keep hearing the Lord say, don't listen to your critics. There are people standing back that have their life and their understanding of God anchored in the status quo, anchored in the way things are, and God wants us to relinquish things as they are for things as he wants them, and he wants to consummate a bride-bridegroom relationship. So this interaction between Ruth and Boaz on her part is it's presumption. You know, you hear people and preachers love to get on this. Whenever, you know, the act of presumption you identify in someone else is usually, more often than not, simply them walking in greater faith than you're willing to walk in. Presumption. And it was a presumption that was not outwardly focused, but inwardly focused. It was completely focused on looking at the bridegroom. If we're going to presume, let us presume inwardly in an act of audacious intimacy with the Father. If we can cross a boundary in pursuit of intimacy with the Father, we might just scratch the surface of the intimacy Jesus died to provide.
Good.
So we're not to be timid in our approach to God, but very bold, for in so doing, we secure for ourselves the betrothal.
Yay, verily.
So we'll begin, Kitty, if you will read now Ruth chapter 3, verses 1 through 5.
Okay. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself therefore, and anoint thee, and put on thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man until he have done eating and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie, and thou shalt go in and uncover his feet and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, all that thou sayest, I will do unto me. I will do.
So I want you to see the familiarity or the comparison between what Ruth is doing here and what the daughters of Lot did. And there's something to be said, and quite honestly, I'm just feeling after something because we relate to God as Father. And the daughters of Lot, they provoked their father to eat and drink and lay down, and they slept with him, and by incest produced the Moabite people, which is where Ruth came from. So anything that makes you do a double take, pray to interpret. And so here is Ruth doing something very much akin to what her ancestors did, the daughters of Lot. But I think we're going to see, so what is the difference? You need to learn to exercise righteous judgment, because you may look and see someone in your life who's doing something that you could look back and say, well, somebody else did that and that was wrong. Okay? You need to learn to judge righteous judgment, because God doesn't look on the outward. He looks on the inward.
Amen.
You really need to hear what I'm saying, because they could have looked at her. Look at that. She's just being a Moabite. Look at what she's doing to Boaz. Because there were many daughters in Israel who looked at Boaz as a prize. He was very wealthy. He was a mighty man. He was like the most eligible bachelor in Israel at that time. And for Ruth, a Moabitess, to do this, they would have instantly compared what she did to what the daughters of Lot did. And I think we're going to see, here's the difference between what Ruth did and what Lot did, Lot's daughters did. They were an unprepared. They were not prepared. They were not, did not have righteousness in their heart. And also, she was relating to Boaz as a bridegroom. They were relating to Lot as a father. There is something God is saying to us in the highest revelation of intimacy that he wants to bring us into. It involves father, but it includes bridegroom. Let me put it that way. Listen to what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. It involves father, but it includes bridegroom. He wants us to begin to see him as the lover of our soul. So let's digress just a moment. Naomi is a widow whose husband Elimelech dies in Moab after sojourning there from Israel. Consequently, her two sons die there as well, leaving both of her daughter-in-laws widows as well. She prevails upon her Moabite daughters-in-law to return to their people, but Ruth refuses. So here's a perfect picture of conversion. She becomes a proselyte. She becomes a convert in her fidelity to her mother-in-law. She becomes a convert. And notice this is a mother-in-law, daughter-in-law relationship. You see, but yet Ruth's conversion was not perfected. Her place in the economy of God was not perfected according to the law. It was perfected according to the consummation of a love relationship between her and Boaz. Mm-hmm. Like the Bible says, the law, in that it was not perfect. It could not redeem us because it was birthed in transgression. It was a remediation of the condition of transgression in the hearts of man. We are not perfected by the law. We're perfected by the consummation of our intimacy and our relationship with Christ. So Ruth refuses to leave her. And she returns then with Naomi to Bethlehem, Judah. But they are impoverished. You know, it's like that song, I Want to Be Born Again Again. You know, you get born again. It's like you're saved, but you're lost. And you get to a certain place. You're looking to Jesus as your Savior, but there are comparative margins of experience between you and people out there that know God that makes you wonder, you know, where is the differentiation? Where is the promise of God? They had promises. They were children of Abraham, but they were impoverished. And so what does she do? Does she sit back and get bitter? No. Now her mother-in-law, she faltered. She said, don't call me Naomi, which means delightsome. Call me Mara, which means bitter. Call me embittered. In other words, her ability to stand fast was hindered. But what did Ruth do? She got up and she did something. She was going to go out and she, in a great, in a measure, she put herself at risk. So she goes out to glean in the fields to forage for food, and just so happens, she did not go to Boaz's fields on purpose. And if she'd even known who Boaz was, she did not know she was her kinsman. It was unknown to her that he is her near kinsman by marriage through her deceased husband. Boaz notices her, and I want you to notice something. When Boaz married her, he was doing right, not just by her, he was doing right by Elimelech. He was doing right by her dead husband. So when you are betrothed unto Christ, he is stepping through your generations. He's stepping back into your bloodline. Amen. To not just to redeem you, but to redeem your bloodline, that your bloodline not be cut off.
Thank you,
because
God.
He's the God of time and eternity. He can do anything he wants anytime he wants.
Amen.
He's not hindered. We are hindered by time. We cannot go back in time Even if we have a hot tub, you know, hot tub time machine. I've never even seen that movie, but I saw the title of it. We can't go back in time, but he can. So Boaz notices her and he instructs his workmen to be kind to her. Who are the workmen? The angels. The angels are commissioned. Why? Because he saw her in the harvest. Kitty has this word in her heart about it. There's going to be ha ha in the harvest.
Amen.
Well, that's a picture of what happens in Ruth. And when they see you in the harvest, when are the angels going to work in your behalf? Had a guy came to our church one time and said he saw our angels with their arms folded because we weren't giving him anything to do. If you want to get your angel active, get out into the harvest.
Amen.
Find out what the harvest looks like. Then she's allowed to, not only are the workmen to be kind to her, but she's allowed to eat and drink with the workers. In other words, she's able to eat and drink angels' food. She has access to the resources that empower angels. And whereupon Boaz, then he explains to her in the previous chapter, he said, I'm doing this for you because I've heard, now listen to this, I've heard of your kindness and your devotion to Naomi. What does Naomi represent to us? He wants to recompense her for choosing to remain supportive of her mother-in-law. Now, here we see the type and shadow of the church's relationship to Israel. Naomi is a type of the nation of Israel and the Jewish people as a whole. Jesus is our Boaz. Boaz saw that Ruth was being kind and supportive of her mother-in-law. He sees that we have an attitude toward the people of Israel, toward the Jewish people, an attitude of kindness. And because of that, he puts the angels to work. Because why I so appreciate Kim Clement, because that's his whole ministry is wrapped up around this very principle of being kind and supportive to the nation of Israel. Angels are activated in your life when you have the proper attitude toward your Naomi, which is the nation of Israel. Now listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying, because we're going to cover this in a comprehensive way, this whole concept of being supportive to Israel. Without Naomi, what do we owe the Jewish people? Without Naomi, Ruth would have had no hope of finding a man like Boaz to take the place of her deceased husband. Boaz is a type of Christ to the lost soul. Through the Jewish nation, God brought Jesus to us. And just as he used Naomi to bring Boaz to Ruth. Boaz favors Ruth because she is devoted and supportive to Naomi. He chooses us because we remember the nation of Israel and we love and support them. Though, even though the nation of Israel rejects Christ and consequently colluded in his crucifixion, yet there were some among them, a remnant, who has said that they waited on the consolation of Israel and they believed that Jesus was the Messiah. Israel, the Jewish people, they are our Naomi. We are blessed as faithful Abraham through Christ Jesus, Galatians 3:29. In the Psalms, we are exhorted regarding Israel, and the city of Jerusalem says this, Psalm 122:6. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee.
Amen.
So in praying for the peace of Jerusalem and being supportive of the Jewish people, that is not to say we agree with everything Israel does. You know, there are statements that Paul and Peter and the writers of the New Testament make that if they were made in some circles today, in evangelical circles and in some churches, they would be accused of being anti-Semitic. I've heard that myself. I've had people tell me, you're anti-Semitic. I said, no, I'm not. I am Jewish. The oldest form, we've done genealogical research, and the oldest form of my surname is Wadenstein. And so I have Jewish blood running in my veins. But just because we're supportive, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and we are supportive of the Jewish people, does not mean to say we agree with everything that they do. Now, let me say something to you, you may or may not realize. Religious intolerance in Israel runs as strong against Christians as it does against Islam. You hear what I'm saying? Religious intolerance is as strong against Christianity in Israel and in Jerusalem as it is in Islam. Now, I understand that there's variations. We're not painting with the broad brush here, but I'm speaking from personal knowledge. We know of Christian missionaries who have been expelled from Israel because they were Christian missionaries. The Jewish people, it is a fact that the Jewish people as a whole largely reject Christ altogether. Now, just because someone is Jewish does not mean to imply they get a pass on whether or not they must accept Jesus as their Savior. And when Jesus came and he appeared to John and talked to him about the seven churches, he referred to Jerusalem as Sodom and Gomorrah. Unredeemed Judaism is Sodom and Gomorrah. But because of their heritage and the legacy they have of being the bloodline that our Savior came from, we love them, we support them, we speak blessings upon them, knowing that God ultimately has a plan to redeem them. But being Jewish, I've heard prominent and well-known ministers claim that being Jewish is equivalent to being born again. That is absolutely untrue. Sooner or later, the Jewish people, either as individuals or as a nation, must come to grips with the claims of Christ and face the consequences of that decision, either accepting Jesus or not accepting Jesus. There will be Jewish people in hell, and there will be Jewish people in heaven. And what determines heaven or hell is not ethnicity or religious persuasion, but what did you do with Jesus? Did you have a personal relationship with Jesus? But yet in the meantime, we love them, we honor them, we advocate for them as the means by which God chose a natural bloodline to bring Jesus into the world. Judaism is to Christianity what Naomi was to Ruth. As Naomi brought Boaz into Ruth's life, so Judaism brought Jesus into the world, and we bless them for it. Amen, Sister Kitty?
Amen, brother.
So Ruth returns from gleaning in the fields of Boaz, but she doesn't realize yet that Boaz is her near kinsman. She tells Naomi, and instantly Naomi knows that God is at work. In the law, when a kinsman died without children, the near kinsman was obligated to marry the widow as a second wife and raise up children to his brother. In fact, there was a man named Ornan and his brothers, who their brother died, and the brother that died had several other brothers, and each of those brothers in turn refused to be the kinsman redeemer, and God struck him dead. Now, by this time in Israel, they take it as you have the option. They didn't, it's like they watered it down. Uh-huh. You don't have to do this, but you can if you want to. So it's not so much a command now as it was a suggestion or an option, not changed that way by the hand of God, but by their religious culture. However, Naomi sees the possibility that God is working to save the family from ruin that they had come to after losing everything in Moab. What does that mean to you? God will not leave you where you are. If you're in a hopeless position, the most important thing you can do is listen to God and do what he said. Naomi was somewhat fatalistic in the beginning, but Ruth is not a person to sit idly by waiting on something to change. She's a woman of action. She goes out and does back-breaking work, setting aside her pride and even her grief as a widow to glean in the fields.
She's a smart woman. She kept her hand to the plow. She was busy doing something. That's what I've seen God move the most spectacular times in my life, is as I stayed busy doing what he put before me. And she wasn't afraid to work and labor.
Kitty calls that keep seeking the kingdom.
Amen.
Now, what about the harvest? This is all happening in the early or the barley harvest. And again, I could just talk at length about the barley harvest, but it's associated with first fruits. When Jesus died and rose again, it was also the time of the barley harvest. When Ruth and Boaz became espoused, it was the time of the barley harvest. When Jesus came out of the tomb and stood talking with Mary, the high priest at that very moment was waving two barley sheaves as a celebration of the first fruits, revealing that Jesus was the first fruits from the dead. So this corresponds to the season that God brought Boaz and Ruth together. It tells us that in the heart of God, when Jesus came out of the tomb, God was after, yes, a father, son-daughter relationship, but beyond that, he was pursuing a bride for a bridegroom. It's not late harvest. There are not other priorities. God wants intimacy with us and with his people as a whole. He's bringing us to rest at the threshing floor, which means he's going to draw us into an intimate embrace with himself. And he's going to do it in a conspicuous way. This took place at the threshing floor with lots of people all around. It was a public display that Ruth got herself involved in. He wanted it to be a conspicuous and a public thing. Naomi gives instructions to Ruth then that apply to us as well. She didn't just get up and say, oh, okay, you know. And I know that when my wife is ready to go out, she makes some preparation. If she's wearing her old cleaning clothes or something like that, she's been working, she's going to go change clothes. She's going to get ready to go out somewhere. And Naomi instructs Ruth how to prepare herself to snuggle up to her Boaz. Amen. At the threshing floor. She tells her, wash yourself. That's what we're doing now. That's why we're teaching expository teaching. The compulsion, the call to do expository teaching is about washing you with the water of the word, according to Ephesians 5:26, which is the Bride of Christ chapter in the Bible. It's all about washing you as a bride to prepare yourself. She was to anoint herself. That's talking about the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. Kitty has some things she anoints herself with occasionally. Yeah. That are just like Ruth got around Boaz, he could smell the anointing oil upon this bride. Kitty gets around me sometimes, she wears that certain perfume, and she's got all my attention, I promise you.
Undivided.
Because of anointing. So she was to wash herself, anoint herself, and then she was to go to the threshing floor. John 4:35, Jesus said, pray that the workers would go into the harvest. Notice, Ruth was doing the same work in the harvest that the workers were, that the scripture tells us are a metaphor for the angels. We're sitting back thinking angels are going to, they don't work for us, they work with us. And they only work with us when we're doing the work that they do. Right. And we see that clearly by comparison here in the book of Ruth. Now notice that Naomi didn't tell Ruth to go to the synagogue. It's like I told somebody one time, all right, do you want me to go into all the world or do you want me to go to church? I can't do both.
Come on now.
Now listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying. I'm saying this by emphasis, not by exclusion. But it bears repeating. Do you want me to go to church or do you want me to go into all the world? Going to church is not the same thing as going into all the world. Mm-hmm. The consummation of Boaz and Ruth did not take place in the synagogue. It took place in the harvest field.
Right.
It's ha ha in the harvest.
Come on.
And she had to go out to the harvest. And if she didn't go out to the harvest, nothing was going to change. You're waiting for change. Go out into the harvest. Find out what seek the kingdom looks like for you.
And just do that.
See, if you're looking for Jesus in your life and in your community, go find the threshing floor. Go into the harvest. You will find him in the harvest. This is the Matthew 6:33 dynamic. If you seek first the kingdom, all these things will be added. She went out into the harvest looking for grain. She came back with a man. She came back with her Boaz. I mean, single people, if you're looking for a wife or a husband, if you're a Boaz, get in the harvest.
Amen.
You just might find her snuggling up to you one night. If you're a Ruth, get in the harvest.
Amen.
God will cause this consummation to take place in the harvest. She found the man in the harvest who eventually became all she ever longed for.
Amen.
This is where the intimacy took place. We tend to see intimacy with God as arising from a sequestered, mystical, and solitary experience. The exact opposite is true. Go and find him in the harvest. We are all marketplace ministers.
Amen.
We are all called to go into the harvest fields of public life and listen to the Holy Ghost as he makes us laborers in the harvest. Now, if you read verse 6 through 11.
Verse 6, and she went down into the floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was merry, he went to lay down at the end of the heap of corn. And she came softly and uncovered his feet and laid her down. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid, and he turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, Who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And he said, Blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast shown more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, inasmuch as thou followest not young men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman.
So let's see the boldness of Ruth. Let's be bold in our intimacy with the Father. Let's be bold to seek out our bridegroom. She could have been rejected by Boaz. She was a widow and she was a foreigner. He could have rejected her and publicly shamed her. He could have accused her and brought about her death. She's a type of the believer who is not timid or hesitant in their relationship with God. The writer of Hebrews says, in Hebrews 4:16 says, let us come boldly before the throne of grace. Let's come so boldly before the throne of grace that we raise the eyes of our bridegroom. Mm-hmm. Did you hear what I said? Let's not come timidly. Let's not come tepidly. Let's not come before him with the thought of, according to some religious protocol of how we approach God. No, let's come like Queen Esther did. Let's come so boldly that you're putting your life at stake. I want to push the envelope of what's available to us in the third heaven. I want to come so brazenly, so boldly, and so insistently, and so desperately that it raises the eyes of God for all the millions of people that have come into his presence, that it takes his breath away, the boldness and the audacity with which we approach him. If I'm going to have a choice between drawing back into dead religion or presuming to the point of risk, let me presume to the point of risk, pressing into his presence.
Amen.
And into relationship with him.
Amen. And let me say here too, God can tell you something. You need to be so open to his plan. He can tell you something that even if you've never heard of it ever happening to somebody before you, like in Ruth's case, it was so out of the box. You need to be prepared, for God can do and say, as we've said so many times, he can do anything he wants, anytime he wants. He doesn't check in with anybody. But the key is to you hearing his voice, no matter how bizarre it sounds, it will be his plan, because he'll confirm it with signs following. And Brother Hagin said one time, listening to the voice of God is about, if you hear him tell you something, even though it's never been told to anybody else to do it, you better obey the voice of God. Because look at the end of it. When she heard that sound, she was in agreement with that sound, and she did it out of the norm. Praise God.
So the boldness was not just in openly demanding Boaz to meet her need, but rather it was Ruth's boldness. It was an act. Now listen to me. If you get any phrase out of this teaching today, it was an act of presumptive intimacy. I want to presume upon the Father's intent of bringing me into intimacy with my bridegroom.
Amen.
The lover of my soul.
That's right.
The wording here is quite delicate. I encourage you to do some study here. She uncovered his feet and lay down. And then she asks him further. She wants a response from him to cover her with his skirt. So she presumes she was the initiator. If this was a movie, they would put it under the genre strong female lead. She was presuming. She was being presumptive. It was a risk, a social risk on her part. And when he sees her, who is this? Mm-hmm. In other words, he had seen her before, but now he sees her in a setting that was unexpected. Let us come so boldly into the presence of God that he sees us in a place, in a depth before him that he hadn't expected to see us before.
Mm-hmm.
And she asked him to cover her with a skirt. This was an act of betrothal in a public place where the eyes of others were watching. And Boaz was apparently a much older man because he remarks that she shows him favor in not choosing one of the young men standing by. You know, when the fire of God burned on the Mount of God, the people gave their earrings to Aaron, and he threw the earrings into the fire, and a young calf jumps out. It represents ministry. And there's always a man or a woman of God ready to jump out of the fire of God's glory and say, "I'm it." Because they give him the gold earrings. That's what you hear with. They give him their ear and they give him their gold. There's always somebody, a young man. She could have chosen any number of young men around Boaz, but she rejected them. We need to be careful not looking to ministry for what we ought to be looking to the Lord for. Amen. Not giving fidelity to ministry for what we, you know, Jesus died for you, not Russ and Kitty. Be careful not to ascribe or to lean dependently upon man for what you ought to be looking to the Lord for. And there's a lot of ministries out there that are willing to pontificate, to be like little Holy Ghost prophetic popes. Yes, kiss my ring and you will become a great and mighty man or woman of God. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. You need to go find your Boaz. It's Christ in you. We are only of value in that we're pointing you to your Boaz. We must decrease that he might increase. And if we ever don't get that, then we are putting ourselves in competition with your Boaz. And I don't think that'll go well for us. Do you?
No, it would never.
So let us take our example from Ruth and come forward to our Lord and Master in a presumptive overture of intimacy and personal relationship. God would rather you presume upon his goodness than assume his austerity and aloofness. If you are presumptive, let it be in pursuit of a deeper intimacy with the Lord. Mm-hmm. And if you'd read verse 12 through the end of the chapter.
And now it is true that I am thy near kinsman, howbeit there is a kinsman nearer than I. Somebody else is in line. Tarry this night, and it shall be in the morning, that if he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman well, let him do the kinsman part. But if he will not do the part of a kinsman to thee, then I will do the part of a kinsman to thee as the Lord liveth. Lie down until morning. And she lay at his feet until morning, and she rose up before one could know another. And he said, let it not be known that a woman came unto the floor. Also he said, bring the veil that thou hast upon thee, and hold it. And when she held it, he measured 6 measures of barley, and laid it on her, and she went into the city. And when she came in to her mother-in-law, she said, who art thou, my daughter? And she told her all that the man had done to her. And she said, these 6 measures of barley gave he me, for he said to me, go not empty unto thy mother-in-law. Then said she, sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall, for the man will not be in rest until he have finished the thing this day.
You see the change that was taking place in Ruth? Boaz knew her. He had seen her for, if you study the passage, she had actually gleaned in his fields for some time. He saw her every day. But when she crawled up under the covers, he said, who are you? And then she goes back to her mother-in-law that she'd been with for many years, and she goes into the house, and the mother-in-law says, who are you? Let me tell you something. Intimacy will change you.
Amen.
I'll never forget the day my mother, after I was ministering in a particular setting under a powerful anointing, she looked at me with just a different tone of voice, and she quoted that verse, that they took knowledge of them that they'd been with Jesus.
Hallelujah.
She saw something different than just her little boy. It's something that John saw when he saw Jesus, who'd been his cousin. He'd probably put him in a half Nelson and picked on him because John was older. He'd probably pestered Jesus as a little boy their whole life, mm-hmm. and had played rough and tumble with him. But when he showed up at the Jordan, he said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world.
To
be able to, that's the way we're supposed to see our near kinsmen. Not see them with the spite and the sarcasm that Jesus referred to when he said a prophet is not without honor except in his own land. The day is coming. We're going to have to strip aside the contamination of the familiar spirits that have devastated and destroyed families and begin to see each other as who we are in the anointing under the Spirit of God.
Amen. And when the Spirit, the change came when the Spirit of God fell on Jesus. And that's the difference in our life. That's why we must be filled with the Holy Spirit. It's on us and in us when we're filled to overflowing.
Let us be washed, anointed, and headed into the harvest. So the intentions now between Boaz and Ruth are established. They intend to become man and wife. However, there is another claim. And Boaz said, let him be the kinsman redeemer if he can do it. That's like the law. Whenever Adam and Eve were to be betrothed unto God, but they decided, made another choice, and so God sent the law. But the law cannot make anybody perfect. The law cannot deal with sin. The law is like our true next of kin, because we're in sin and the law was brought about to deal with sin. But law could not perfect us. Oh, you can't do the job? Then it's my turn, Jesus says. Let me perfect them through intimacy, not through religious protocol. Amen. So another man is closer to her than Boaz. What does that apply to us? When we come to Jesus and desire to be close to him and enter into relationship with him, we find that there is another legal claim. When Adam and Eve yielded to Satan, they entered into a familial covenant with the serpent. That is why Jesus, four times in the Gospels, called mankind sons of the devil, a generation of vipers. Do you realize when you come to Christ, as you the state you were in when you were born into this world, this is why Jesus said you have to be born again. That when you are born into this world, you have a closer kinship with Satan himself than you do with God. That's why I believe it was King David said that children are born in hypocrisy speaking lies. Now, what is the lie that a baby tells when he's born? He says, I am the center of my own universe. That baby is completely and totally self-conscious. But that is not how God created us. Amen. God created us to be completely and totally God-conscious from the womb. That's why they didn't know they were naked until after they sinned. Because before they sinned, God-consciousness in them obscured and eclipsed self-consciousness. And the self-consciousness is a sign of the contamination of sin. The sign of the characteristic of the serpent, what the Bible refers to in some places as the mortal coil. And that's a whole other conversation. When Adam and Eve yielded to Satan, they came into a familial covenant with the serpents. That is why Jesus referred, again, we talked about that. When we come to Christ, we are in closer kinship to Satan himself than we are with God. That's why Jesus said we must be born again. Now, looking at that, think about this. Boaz was not really the nearest kin someone else was. And that someone else is a type of the adversary of Satan himself. There is a teaching going around today that everyone will be saved whether they accept Jesus as Savior or not. Another perversion of that I mentioned earlier, that being born Jewish is equivalent to being born again. No, it's not. This teaching, it's called, you can call it universalism, ultimate reconciliation. They have a lot of names for it. It has accompanying themes such as hell really doesn't exist other than as a metaphor. Or the teaching that you may go to hell if you don't accept Jesus, but he won't allow you to stay there. If any of these teachings are true, they neglect the need of a Savior.
That's right.
They negate the need of a Savior. Because they deny the fact that we are closer in kinship to the sworn enemy of God than we are to God himself. They ignore, by intellectual artifice, the reality of the fallen nature. And you need to, and don't just take my word for it, you need to search the scriptures out yourself. But there are very influential ministers, people like Carlton Pearson, people like Donnie, the guy that took over Chapel Hill Harvester Church, Donnie Earl Polk is one, and many, many others. They're saying it doesn't matter, that the conduct of your life does not matter. God loves everybody. Everybody's going to heaven. It doesn't matter what. You need to understand, your conduct in life is the fruit of your spiritual state. And the Bible defines for us not just Judeo-Christian morality as it needs to be applied in the Western world. It defines for us what the fruit of life in Christ looks like and what the fruit of life outside Christ looks like. And if we are, if you are dealing with one, or if you yourself have fruit in your life, evidence in your lifestyle that does not fit the profile as manifested in the scripture, then the paternity of God has yet to be fulfilled, has yet to be initiated in your life, and the born again experience has not taken hold. And now today, because of the generational burden of sin, that men are not able to ignore it any longer, so they're coming up with these convoluted doctrines, say there is no hell, everybody's going to heaven. If that be true, then Jesus died in vain. And we see clearly in the metaphor of Ruth having another kinsman redeemer who had a right to her, and Boaz says, okay, go ahead and marry her if you can. And we'll find the fact that he couldn't, and he didn't. Who's with me?
You're with you, Papa.
See, there is an accusation against the... See, if we accept that to thinking, then we're accepting an accusation against the character of God. It suggests that the cross and hell and the need for salvation is more God's need than ours. If God would just get over it. Mm-hmm. You know, our understanding of God is that, you know, he's just going to get over it one day. He's just going to get over the fact that we're all born enemies of God, aliens of the Commonwealth of Israel. And so we make it God's shortcoming and not man's. Do you see how despicable that is?
And you can see why the enemy's fought so hard to keep people from going to the harvest fields. He knows the end. He knows he'll be in the lake of fire, wants company. And he's despicable about misleading and misguiding people. They wouldn't be going into harvest fields to preach the gospel, and he would think that he would win, but it's too late.
Well, and the danger of that is, like people like Donnie Polk and Carlton Pearson and many others I could name, the revulsion of the religious crowd who are into salvation by works and performance-based religion, they complain long and loud about that thinking, and the temptation is to fall into their ranks, mm-hmm. rather than staying firmly rooted and grounded in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. We do not want to, you know, put on placards, the end is near, hell is real. Mm-hmm. We don't want to do any of that. We want to, I only have eyes for my beloved.
Amen.
I'm not interested in the shrill crowd out there citing all the nuances of the law, and most of their laws are not rooted in the scripture, they're rooted in Christian traditions. And I'm not interested in that. Neither am I interested in those on the other end of the stick who are just libertines and everything goes and everybody's going to heaven and I'm okay, you're okay. No, I'm not okay, and guess what? You're not okay either. We all have need of a savior. So there is another that has a legitimate claim to Ruth, and this is a type of Satan himself. He had a claim. He has a claim on your life that goes all the way back to Adam and Eve, because you were in Adam and you were in Eve, according to God's way of looking at things, when the fall took place. He had a claim to the lost that was established in the covenantal transaction between Satan and Adam and Eve. We are born enemies of God. We are aliens from the Commonwealth of Israel. We are a generation of vipers. We need a savior. But Jesus, like Boaz, notice that. Boaz says somebody else has claim on you, and he could have backed out right there. But he didn't. At that point, he chose to accept reproach upon himself. Why, you dirty old man?
Whatever.
Because, see, he didn't have legitimate right. By the law, Jesus had no claim to the bride of Christ. He accepted our reproach. By the law, Boaz had no claim. And if Boaz did not have a claim, it makes what happened when they met at the threshing floor a transgression. Because she uncovered his feet, or she uncovered his nakedness. Now listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying. But by law, if he was not the kinsman redeemer, then what happened at the threshing floor was transgression. And so Boaz, in not turning her out and rejected her, he's saying to Ruth, I'm going to accept your reproach. God's going to work this thing out. Mm-hmm. And isn't that exactly what Jesus did for us? Mm-hmm. He, like Boaz, was willing to bear our reproach. Boaz could have easily said, no, you belong to another. But in choosing to get involved, Boaz brings reproach on himself. And just as Jesus, he bears our reproach. It bears the reproach of your sin upon himself. And if you love your espoused, I know for me, I don't ever want to have a negative effect on Kitty at all. Mm-hmm. If I'm doing anything to burden her, if I'm doing anything, and I would never, you know, you see couples sitting around in public places and they make these snide remarks against each other and cutting humor, and they're hard mm-hmm. on each other and mean spirited. You will never hear Russ and Kitty doing that. Ever, ever, ever.
Never.
Because let me tell you something. It cost me to be with this woman. It cost her to be with me. I would never despair. I would never do anything. And so maybe there's something in your life that you can live with and feel like you have a relationship with God. But what is the impact it's had? What do you see in the eyes of your Boaz? Mm-hmm. Is that burdening him? Is that disparaging him before others? Is somehow that impacting him in a way that leaves him other than being blessed to be in relationship with you? I don't want anything in my life that is a burden to my master. He bears every one of the reproaches that come against me. He bears upon himself. And I want to walk worthy to that, not according to religious legalism and a performance-based approach to God, but out of that deep, intimate, presumptive intimacy by which we took our lives in our hands and we clung to the Savior, and a marriage took place and true holiness was birthed, not this religious legalistic monstrosity we call holiness.
Thank you, Father, again, the powerful word, the revelation and the inspiration of your word. It's overwhelming at times, but it does bring us back around to who Jesus is. And as Amanda said, Father, it's you loved us so much that you came. You yourself lowered yourself so that you could save us in sending your son, that precious seed of you, God. And we want to give you your due. We want you to see your seed in our life and be satisfied. Thank you for strengthening us every day to do, to be resolved, to only do what we see the Father do, and to only speak those things that are pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.